Good evening. All honor, all power, and all glory belongs to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Welcome to our Wednesday night Bible study. Hallelujah. I'm glad you're able to come in and get fed the Word of God tonight. Are you ready? As I always ask of you, to please get your pencil, your paper, your Bible, and a glass of water, and let's get ready to have a wonderful time, and let's see what the Lord has for us. Oh, wonderful, wonderful. I hope you all had a blessed and wonderful day. So welcome to the house of the Lord here in our new location in Reverend Dr. Mark V.C. Taylor's office. Hallelujah. Now, I'm going to go forward with my job that I'm supposed to do, and that is to have devotion. So please help me to sing this song. It's simple but great. Everybody say amen. 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 In the morning. Amen. 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 In the evening. Amen. Come on now. Amen. 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 Sing louder. Amen. Give God glory. Amen. This evening. Amen. 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 One more time now. Amen. Give God glory. Amen. This evening. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. I hope you received that. I know I did. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Now, please join me in the Word. I'm reading from the NIV. I'm coming from the book of Exodus, chapter 20, starting at verse 1. Now, if you're able to stand, please do so and follow along with me, starting at verse number 1. And God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord, your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Verse 8, remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. And on it you shall not do any work, neither you nor sons, your sons or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreign residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heaven and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. And my New Testament scripture, I'm coming from 1 John chapter 2, verses 1 through 6. And it reads like this. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. And not only for our sins, but also for the sins of the whole world. And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Join me in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, it's with great joy that we come before your throne this evening, Father. Holy, holy is your name, Father, for you are worthy to be praised, Father. We thank you, Father, for all that you do and are about to do, Lord God. Lord, we need another filling of your Holy Spirit. So fill us right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Father, I even ask that as you bring forth our leader, Reverend Taylor, fill him with the Holy Spirit, Father, and anointing. But Father, hide him behind the cross and fill him with what you want us to hear tonight, Father, as he leads us in your word, Lord God. Thank you for your word, Father. It is so useful to our lives, Father God. Help us to implant it in our body, mind, and soul so we can live by it and be obedient to your word, Father God, so we can please you. So, Lord God, bless those that are in earshots of by the phone, by Facebook, by YouTube, Father. Bless those that are tuning in right now, Father. Oh, touch them. If they have any ailments, move it out the way so they can receive what you have for them, Lord God. Father, I ask that you bless those that are sick and shut in, Lord God. Those that are able to not move but able to hear. Bless them too, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. So, Father, touch your people around the world, Lord God. Touch our politicians, Lord God. Touch our members of the Church of the Open Door, Lord God. Touch our deacons, our ministers, Lord God. Our trustees, Father, bless them too as they tune in to get the word tonight, Father God. So, Lord, oh, we love you, we adore you, we need you right now. But bless your holy name, and we thank you in advance. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Oh, it gives me great pleasure to bring forth a hardworking individual who does whatever needs to be done when the Lord tells him to move. So let me get out the way and bring forth Reverend Dr. Mark V.C. Taylor! All power, all glory, all honor belong to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We are here on another Wednesday night coming to you from the pastor's office. Amen. Where there's an open door. As a matter of fact, that door is open. Close that door. Amen. We'll open up all the other doors. Close. Oh, yeah. All right. We have so many machines and cords here. We thank God for another opportunity to come into your homes, onto your screens, into your devices, and hopefully into the hearts and minds, amen, of each and every one of you tonight. We thank God for another opportunity. We thank God for life, and we thank God for God's blessings. Amen. We have some flies flying around here. Amen. I've been in here for an hour, and there was no fly flying around here. And when I started teaching, cut the switch up, daughter, and let's bring some cold in here. That's it. Amen. Let's freeze the devil out.
Yes.
Hallelujah. All right. But as I was saying, I'm so happy to be able to come into your homes, and we come tonight because we have sanctified the word of God in our lives. We've sanctified the word of God in our hearts, and we know we need Bible study. We had a great week last week, a long, good week last week. We're just happy that you are here tonight. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So we're going to go to our lesson tonight immediately and get right into this lesson. I want to thank God for Deacon Flowers.
Amen.
Amen. Not only does he lead devotion, he comes and sets up our machines. We want to thank God for Sister Ziana Richardson, our technician,
And we're trying to do some new things. So tonight we have the office full of different machines, and we've been moving around in different places, and we're just having a good time in the Lord. We're just happy tonight to be here. So we're not going to delay. We're going to go into 1 Timothy. We're in the second chapter, and I'm going to read verses 1 through 7, and I'm going to concentrate on 7 tonight. Verses 1 through 7, and I'm going to concentrate on 7 tonight. Hear now the word of God, and I'm reading tonight from the Revised Standard Version. First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for all men, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life, godly and respectful in every way. This is good and is acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, the testimony to which was born at the proper time. For this, I was appointed a preacher, an apostle. I am telling the truth, I am not lying, a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and in truth. This, brothers and sisters, is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Let's bow our head as you take your seats. Father God, we just thank you for another day. Lord, we ask you to take over, fill us with the Holy Spirit. And God, we just ask that you get the glory, get the honor, get the worship tonight as you impart in us the living word. God, you know what we need. You know where we are. You know what's going on in our lives. Take over right now and glorify and magnify yourself. This is our prayer. We pray in the name above every name, the mighty and the matchless name of the Lord Jesus. God's people say, amen. Amen. All right. So, last week, I just want to say something. Last week, oh boy, last week was such a good week. I just want to, just being attacked here. Amen. Now, sometimes you have to fight the devil. And I know I'm streaming. I wouldn't normally do this, but these flies are flying up into the Bible. They fly. I was in here last week. A fly flew in my lens, between my lens and my eye. So we are going to war here. If you all know me, if you've been in my office, you know I hate flies. Amen. Beelzebub is the lord of the flies. The ancient symbol for Beelzebub was a fly. So when I start talking, and again, I was sitting here, I was in a counseling session for an hour, and no fly was in here. Now we come to the word of God, here come the flies. But I want to go back for a minute and go back to last week, because I think I ended on a part that bears repeating. And that is Jesus being the mediator between God and humanity, the man Christ Jesus, or the man Messiah Jesus. Christ means Messiah. And I said that the problem of humanity was sin, and that the solution to sin was the Messiah Jesus. And I raised the question, how is Jesus the solution to sin? Number one, he satisfies the justice of God. The Bible says he gave himself. One of the defining elements of any Christian is to give herself, to give himself. If we're going to be saved, we've got to give ourselves, not just our money, not just attendance in church, but we have to learn how to give ourselves. And the Lord Jesus gave himself as a ransom for all people. All right? And when we deal with Christ being a ransom for all people, we're dealing with him satisfying the justice of God. God was angry at sin. And in the Old Testament, God destroyed humanity because of their sinfulness. And having done it, God said, I'll never do that again. He came forward with his ultimate plan, his best plan. And that was for the sin of humanity to satisfy the wrath of God. God came himself in a body, all right? And he came and he existed and he ministered and gave a depiction of what true freedom and what true grace is like. And then that body, hallelujah, the wrath of God was poured out on that body. The wrath of God was poured out on that identity. The wrath of God was poured out on Jesus for you and I. He was a substitute. He was a propitiation. He was an atonement. So the wrath of God came on him because he had not sinned. He knew no sin, but all the sin was put on him, and it was so much on him, it's like he became sin. And so at the cross, and that's why the cross is our pivotal symbol. We have other symbols, the dove, the Holy Spirit, the fire, the Holy Spirit, the water in baptism. But the major symbol of Christianity is the cross, because the cross is the great turning point. It is the point at which the wrath of God is satisfied by God in Christ. No one else could take all that sin being poured on. No one else had the mixture of God and humanity so that they could walk perfectly in the earth. And so because that was poured out on Christ, he became the satisfaction for the justice of God. And he became the one who can give us and bring us into the righteousness of God. Mm-hmm. How is Jesus the solution to sin? Number one, he's the satisfaction of the justice for God, justice of God. How is Jesus, the solution for sin? Number two, he brought the principle of salvation into the universe. He brought the principle of salvation. Salvation being a divine initiative to redeem all creation. The Lord Jesus Christ brought that into the universe. He restored the power of good by the resurrection of the dead. He restored the power of good. We know that good is going to triumph in the end because in the resurrection, life defeats death. Hallelujah. I was reading the other day, and I was studying 1 Corinthians 15 and 56, I believe it is. It says, the sting of death is sin. And in one version, I believe the New Living Translation, it says, the power of sin is in the law. 57 says, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. How do we have the victory? Because, and of course, 1 Corinthians 15 is about what? It's about resurrection. How do we have the victory? Because Christ resurrected. Christ's resurrection guarantees, woo, I beat the devil. Hallelujah. All right. You won't fly in my Bible study no more, devil. Ha, ha, ha. You all excuse me. I know this is terrible. I know people are saying, Reverend Taylor, swatting flies, but this fly had to go. All right. Hand me some wipes over there so I can clean my hands. Killing flies, barehanded. Come on, sister, hand me some wipes. Now, as I was saying before I was interrupted by that little Beelzebub, amen. Is it something? Okay. Mm-hmm. As I was saying before I was interrupted by that little Beelzebub, that little fly there, Jesus' resurrection guarantees the triumph of good over evil. Death come because of sin. The Bible said the wages of sin is death. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15, by his sin, the first primordial man, Adam, brought death into the world. But there are two pivotal men in history. The first is Adam. By his disobedience to God, he brought sin into the world. The second is Christ. By his obedience to God, he brought salvation into the world. And salvation for all men. Salvation even for the creation. Because we know in Romans 8 that the creation is groaning and moaning. And we know now we living in the time of climate change. You know, if you stepped out last night, you know that it's getting cold. All right? Because autumn is coming in fast. All right? So Christ's resurrection is a restoration of the triumph of good. And that's part of salvation. But part of the principle of salvation is not just the guarantee of the triumph of good over evil, but it's also the pattern of struggle and suffering for redemption. How does Christ defeat sin? Because he shows us how sin has to be defeated. There must be a struggle. And in the struggle, somebody has to suffer. Now, I know y'all don't like this because all these other preachers are telling you, it's your time, it's your season. Go expand your territory. But listen, let me tell you something. Christianity is not just about what you want and what you think you should have. Christianity is about the will of God as expressed in Christ Jesus. And what Christ Jesus does in solving the problem of sin, he shows us the pattern of struggle. If sin is going to be defeated, there has to be a struggle. If sin is going to be defeated, there has to be a sacrifice. You come from a family like I do of drinkers and alcoholics. Somebody's got to receive the gospel. Somebody's got to receive the unction of the Holy Spirit and struggle against alcoholism. Somebody, if you come from a family where there's incest and lust, somebody's got to stand up and call it out and say, Uncle Joe raped Cousin Susie. And everybody know what Uncle Joe did. We don't like to talk about Uncle Joe because we like Uncle Joe. Because his wife gives everybody good Christmas gifts. Y'all know how families are. But if there's going to be an end to sin, it has to be a struggle. And somebody has to sacrifice and tell the truth. Whenever you sacrifice, listen, hell is not going to clap. There's going to be some pain. There's going to be some repercussion. Listen, you want to defeat sin in your family, you're going to have to struggle. You want to defeat sin in your family, you're going to have to make some sacrifices. You want to break the propensity to alcoholism. You want to break the propensity to incest. You want to break the propensity to family disintegration. You want to break the propensity to addictions. It has to be a struggle. And there has to be a sacrifice. And that is what the life of Christ shows us. But he says there in 1 Corinthians 15 and 58, therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, because of the resurrection of Christ, and this whole dissertation about the resurrection, first man, the second man, it comes down to 1 Corinthians 15 and 57. Christ in the resurrection in the past gives us victory today and is the guarantee of the victory of God in the future. And what does the Bible say in terms of us living out the principle of salvation in the universe? Therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be steadfast. I'm in the King James, I'm quoting from in my memory. Be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord, your struggle, your sacrifice is not in vain in the Lord. Your attempt to keep on going when others have given up, your attempt to keep on going when you see no light, you see no hope, your attempt to keep on pushing, to keep on bringing the will of God into your family, to never stop praying, to never stop fasting, to never stop believing, all of that is not in vain in the Lord. Because you're guaranteed, your victory is guaranteed by the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because he has brought the principle of salvation into the entire universe. How does Christ defeat sin? Number one, he's the satisfaction of the justice of God. Number two, he brought the principle of salvation in the universe. Number three, he baptizes his church in the Holy Spirit. When I say baptizes, I mean he fills his church. Your baptism in the Holy Spirit is the first time you are baptized in the Spirit. Before that, you didn't have the Holy Spirit, then you're baptized in the Spirit. Well, you might have had the Spirit to get saved, but you would never fill. Saved don't mean fill. And you all know my example. This glass of water is not filled. I open it and I drink some of it. But if I were to open another glass and pour it till it was overflowing, hallelujah, that's the filling of the Holy Spirit. Baptism means the overflow. When you're baptized, we take you under and the water flows over you. And so the filling of the Holy Spirit means an overflow of the Holy Spirit. Now, there are manifestations of this. There are gifts with this. But listen, don't wait until you're in church to be filled with the Holy Spirit. In your personal devotional time, you can be filled with the Holy Spirit. Don't wait till you get to church. I'd be messed up if I waited for church to get filled with the Holy Spirit. When you seek God and you fast and you pray, when you seek God and you open yourself up, when you study your word, when you give yourself to praise, when you give yourself over to meditation, and there are times that the Spirit fills you. But the Spirit fills you because the Lord Jesus baptized the church in the Holy Ghost. And the Lord Jesus, hallelujah, baptizes you in the Holy Spirit. Because you can't get who Christ is until you've been baptized, till you've been overwhelmed, till you've been overshadowed by Jesus Christ. You can get a church experience. Hallelujah. You can get a church experience, but that's not being filled with the Spirit of God. You can get church ritual. You can say the right things and do the right things, but there must be a time when the Spirit of God overwhelms you. That's what the book of Acts teaches. Hallelujah. How do you be filled with the Spirit? By hearing the Word of God. You can be filled with the Spirit in these Bible studies. Many times, when I come here and preach and teach, I feel terrible. I feel tired. But when I get to the Word of God and I start to deliver the Word of God, I am filled with the Holy Spirit. And when I'm filled with the Holy Spirit, I don't always start speaking in tongues. You know I speak in tongues, but I don't always start speaking in tongues. Sometimes when I'm filled with the Holy Spirit, I'll just say, bow my head. But I know I'm not operating on my own. Sometimes the Lord tell me things that I did not know, don't have written down, comes through the Holy Spirit. Sometimes in this Bible study. And I don't always shout, speak in tongues, run. That's just a cultural thing, hallelujah, that I like to do because it's therapeutic for me. It helps me get over my stress and my anxiety. And it helps me break out of stuff by screaming and hollering. I was screaming before I was filled with the Holy Ghost. I was screaming and hollering in other places. I was going to football games, screaming and hollering. I was going to parties, screaming and hollering. Okay. I was on the dance floor, screaming. The roof is on fire. Hallelujah. But once I got on fire with the Holy Spirit, oh hallelujah, then the Bible says that brings us into the fullness of God. And I want to encourage you always to have a spiritual experience. Nicodemus was religious, but he wasn't born of the Spirit. Nicodemus was knowledgeable, but he wasn't born of the Spirit. Nicodemus was a good man, but he wasn't born of the Spirit. That which is born of flesh is flesh, but that which is born of Spirit is the Spirit. And this is how the Spirit is. You don't know where the Spirit came from. You don't know where the wind came from. You don't know where the wind is going. Jesus said, so is everyone that's filled with the Spirit. So does everyone that's born of the Spirit, he said. That's what he said. And that means when you're under spiritual control, you're not trying to control everything. When you're under spiritual control, you're just seeing what God is going to do with you. You say, Lord, here I am. Lord said, go over here and do this. Go over here and do that. Sit still and be quiet. Speak up over here. Meditate over here. Stop doing this. Give this person this. Give this person that. Go over here and receive this. So how does that deal with the problem of sin? Because the things you used to do, you don't want to do anymore. Places you used to go, you don't want to go anymore. The joy that you used to have in doing things is not the same. Hallelujah. You got new joys now. You got new things that excite you. You're excited when you tell people about God. You're excited when you help people. You're excited when you serve the Lord in the capacity that the Lord called you.
Amen.
Now, this is very important. You'll see why I went into this for this connection tonight. The Bible says that at the appropriate time, God brought forth this testimony about Jesus. And I talked about how in God there is a eternal now. Hallelujah. Now is the time. Who gave himself as a ransom for all, the testimony to which was brought at the proper time. Tonight is the proper time for you to get closer to God. Tonight, right now, is the proper time for me to get closer to God. This is the proper time. And what's the proper time with God who stands outside of time? Anytime. Oh, hallelujah. That's not in my notes. The Lord just showed it to me right now. What's the proper time with God? Anytime. Anytime you're ready, God has already been ready. Anytime you're willing, God has already been willing. Anytime you believe, God has already told you and gave you promises so you could believe. So anytime is the right time with God. And then he gets to verse 7. Hallelujah. This is the proper time. Songwriter said, this is the day that the Lord has made. Then he gets to verse 7. For this That was to give testimony at the proper time. For this, I was appointed a preacher and apostle. I'm telling the truth, I'm not lying. A teacher of the Gentiles in faith and in truth. Now, Paul oftentimes talks about his call. Oftentimes he talks about, well, three times the Bible talks about Paul meeting Christ on the road to Damascus. But Paul talks about, because he had to defend himself. And if you're a Christian, God is using you. Somebody gonna attack you. Say they don't believe you. Say you're not this, you're not that. You might have to defend yourself. And you want to know that you were appointed. How do you know that you were appointed? Because different things in life converge to show you. How do you know that you were appointed? You have a burning fire of a certain type. How do you know that you were appointed? You can't have peace when you don't fulfill your appointment. And this is Paul. Paul said, woe is me, woe be unto me if I preach not the gospel. I got to preach. Why? Because I was appointed. I was called. But before I was called, I was appointed. God said, this man will do this. God said, this woman will do this. God makes an appointment. Paul was appointed to be a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and in truth. How much time I got left?
30 minutes.
30 minutes. I want to spend this last 30 minutes talking about verse 7. Because if you're not careful, you'll miss the deep profundity of this verse. Paul, writing later in his career, says he was appointed to be two things. First, a preacher. And if you read the book of Acts, after Paul was converted, he received his sight, he started preaching. And the people was like, wait a minute, what is this the dude trying to arrest everybody? Wait, didn't I see him when they killed that Stephen guy? Wasn't he holding the coats? Isn't he an accessory to murder? Yes, if you in New York law, if you involved in a murder, you could be arrested for murder too. You called an accessory. And when Paul held the coats, he was an accessory to murder. That's why we should never give up on people, because God uses some of the worst people to do his will once he changes them around. And we are witness to that, many of us, okay? But Paul is appointed a preacher. In the book of Acts, Paul started preaching before he got a license, before he was ordained. When the church was scared of him because they thought he was going to lock him up, Paul started preaching. And he realized that he was appointed to be a preacher. And again, let me just say, one of the ways that you realize something is read 1 Corinthians 14. The Bible says the gifts are made manifest. One of the ways that you're called to something, it just keeps coming up. It just keeps coming out. You just keep doing it. You just keep helping people. You just keep discerning spirits in the room. That's how you know your gift. You can't control your tongue all the time. I don't mean cursing. I mean speaking in unknown tongue. You in a group, you become the leader of the group. You had a gift of leadership, gift of administration. You had a gift of faith. Other folk trembling, you saying God is going to work it out. And it keeps coming up. This is one of the clues to what God has appointed us to. Another way we know what we're appointed to is all the doors keep opening up. Every door keep opening up, you keep walking through. All right? And if you think about it, a lot of the blessings in your life, you didn't work for it. You didn't look for it. Some of them just came to you. Now, you worked and you were ready. Yes, let's get that. You worked and you were prepared, but an opportunity came. And God brought you the opportunity and you walked on in. It amazes me how people ask me, come and do this, come and do that. And I have opportunity to do things I never thought I would have had opportunity to do. Once I was in Washington and I called up Congressman Ed Towns. He said, come on, have lunch with me. Not only did we have lunch, he took me in the Capitol. There's a little train going under the Capitol. Got me in the train. I was with all these senators. He was saying, this is Dr. Taylor from Brooklyn. They was like, oh, Dr. Taylor. They was acting like I was really somebody. I was like, hey, this is nice. And so there we went. We ate. And then we went back on the floor. Later on, he carried me to a dinner with some lobbyists. And, you know, they were trying to spruce him up. They wanted to be friends with him. And it was interesting. Okay, but I didn't. I told him I was in town. I wanted to say hello. And he said, come on down. He opened up the door of opportunity. A lot of times you got to places in your life because a door was opened up. That's one way that you know you were appointed. How do you know that you were appointed? After you start, you see God move. And you see God bless in a way that you just didn't think God was going to bless. You see God use you. Now the church is God using everybody. The church is not just, oh, God used the pastor. Oh, God used the deacons. Oh, God used the people up front. No. We are members of one body, 1 Corinthians 12 teaches us, and we're all connected. We all are gifted. And as we use our gifts in the context of the body, we get blessed. These are some of the ways you know that you were appointed. And then you had a conviction that this is what you do. This is what you do. So Paul knew I was appointed to be a preacher. And different things in my life, the Lord showed me I was a preacher. Even when I walked away from God, even when I backslid, you know what my friends nicknamed me? The preacher. Mm. I didn't want to do that. But they said when I got a little drink, I started talking about God. And of course, Friday and Saturday, we would go out and we would drink. All right? And they would say, look, man, my friends tell me, look, man, we're going out. We went in that God stuff. And I would say, what you talking about? They say, every time you get a little taste, you start talking about God. And I was like, y'all lying. They said, we're going to go back to this place. They took me back to somewhere we went. And I walked in, and these girls said, that go the preacher. I said, oh, God. I was backslidden. I wasn't trying to hear nothing about God. I wasn't trying to preach. But the gift and the calling of God, the Bible say, are without repentance. And when God has appointed you to do something, this is about you. I'll just use myself as an example. When God has appointed you to do something, you will know because it keeps coming up. It keeps nagging at you. There's a prompting in your heart. Other people at peace doing something else. God say, no, I want you over here. Paul knew he was appointed to be a preacher. He probably was preaching before he was a Christian. He's probably a Pharisee preacher. We know that he was a Pharisee of Pharisees. But that's not all. He says first he was appointed to be a preacher. Then he was appointed to be an apostle. He started starting churches. He started traveling a lot. Now, Peter traveled. Peter traveled from Galilee to Rome. But nobody in the early church traveled like the Apostle Paul. He went all over Asia Minor starting churches. And we know the churches he started because of the letters. Thessalonica, Thessalonica, Colossians, Colossae, Philippians, the district of Philippi, Ephesians, the city of Ephesus, Galatians, the province of Galatia, Corinthians, the city of Corinth, Romans, the city of Rome. Paul went everywhere and preached, and he started churches, and he helped to guide those churches. Now, as time went on, he saw this is in the will of God. Some things that you do, you don't know starting off, that you're going to be blessed in the will of God like you're going to be. I was listening to two great sports figures, Shannon Sharp and Mark Jackson. Shannon Sharp was interviewing Mark Jackson. Shannon Sharp said, when you first met Michael in college, did you know he was going to be the Michael Jordan he became? And Mark Jackson said, yeah, you could tell. Because it was something different about it. Then he asked him that about LeBron James. He said, when you, Mark Jackson, met LeBron James, LeBron was a teenager. He said, did you know he would be what he was going to be? He said, yes, I could tell that this was a figure unlike other figures. Well, hallelujah. Some things you can't tell right away. You got to keep walking and serving God. And then you'll see how God gives you ministries you didn't know you would have. When I came to this church, I was told, don't get around children. Children will always accuse you of doing something. Don't. And when children come around you, get away from them. Don't let children in your office. Don't sit around children. That's the way to stay safe. And I tried to do that, but I really feel like that's not me. I'm not like that. I ain't that kind of person. I'm going to be the kind of person I am, and I'll take my chance. And sure enough, I was accused not too long ago, if you remember. But I wasn't going to sacrifice who I was. Neither should you. We got to obey our conscience. Okay, some things we got to do. But I didn't know that God would have a ministry in me of dealing with children, you know, many of whom whose fathers were not around, whose fathers were not good. I didn't know that when I came here. I wasn't thinking about that. I never asked any child to come around me. I never asked any person to come around me, okay? And so I found out this was a ministry, to be a godfather. Man, that was something I never thought of. But it's a serious ministry, and I took it serious. And God has blessed. I had a chance this year to travel, and I seen how a lot of children raised in the church were blessed by seeds that was planted by many others, including me, long ago. All right? And you'll see this in your life. You'll see that God has put you in places where you didn't think you would be. You see that God has given you ministries. I didn't know I would have a ministry like this. I was talking to Deacon Brickhouse the other day. I was telling the youth fellowship how Deacon Brickhouse helped to change the church in many ways. Many ways. Deacon Brickhouse is the one that brought a 3-day Women's Day. Deacon Brickhouse is the one who started prayer. Deacon Brickhouse and some other women were in that room praying for God to shake up the church. Reverend Keeler resigned, and they had a pastoral search, and God told me to resign in Chicago. I didn't know nothing about church at Open Door, and the Lord put us together. So I was telling the youth that Deacon Brickhouse had helped change the church. She had been to church where they were free and shouting and praising God. She started the intercessors. She got on the praise team. She helped to change the church. Now, I know Deacon Brickhouse, years ago, she didn't know she would be a deacon. I know she didn't know she would have all these prayer ministries. She did it, but there probably was a time she didn't know she'd be in the youth fellowship. And she's been in the youth fellowship over 40 years. It's an example of how once you say yes to God, God doesn't just do one thing with you. God does multiple things. So once Apostle Paul got knocked down, and then he got up, once the Lord restored his sight, he said yes, he started preaching. He didn't know he was going to start all these churches. He didn't know he was going to write, oh my God, Romans. 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, 1 Thessalonians, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy. He didn't know all that. He did not know when he was writing this that we would be reading this stuff 2,000 years later. He didn't know that. But because he said yes to God and because he fulfilled his appointment, that's why you hear Paul, he's going to say right here, he's going to tell other people, fulfill your ministry. And fulfilling your ministry means saying yes to God and finding all the things that God wants you to do. All the things that were unknown to you. One of the essential principles and characteristics about God, when God does one thing, God is doing 1,000. And when God calls you to one ministry, there's many avenues, there's many streams of that river. As many streams of that river, there's many things involved in that. God calls you to be a mentor. God calls you to be a counselor. God calls you to be a giver. God might call you to be a janitor. God might call you to, you never know. I told my uncle I was called to preach. He said, good, go clean up the bathrooms. I was cleaning up the bathroom. That wasn't what I thought he was going to say. I was cleaning up the bathroom saying, what does this have to do with being a preacher? One day after one of our anniversaries, we had a member who had a terminal illness. She had an accident in the bathroom. She lost control of her bowels. And while losing control, she slipped. And there was feces all over the ceiling, all over the mirror, all over the wall. My mother went in there. My mother came out hollering. Oh, he said, Red, everybody was gone. I would ask the deacons to come help me. Deacon's gone. And I said, okay, mama, take off my coat. We're going to get to it. And she said, you gonna clean it yourself? I said, Mom, we can't leave this here. She said, come on, I'm gonna help. She had on her mother anniversary clothes. So we all took off our stuff and cleaned up. She said, "Woo!" She said, "I'm glad I taught you how to clean." She said, "I didn't know you'd be cleaning the bathroom for the church." You never know what God will have you to do. You never know who God will have you to speak to. White people, black people, Asian people, Oriental people, or Asian people. You don't know who God will tell you to speak to. You don't know where God will put you. You know, but all of this is part of God appointing you. This is what Apostle Paul found out. Now, how much time we got left?
15 minutes.
So he didn't know he would be a preacher. The last thing Paul thought he was going to be is a Christian preacher. He was arresting Christians. He wanted to kill Christians. When they killed Stephen, he was like, "Good, get him." He came to, he's coming to Damascus to arrest Christians, put them in jail. And he wound up being a Christian preacher, being a Christian apostle. He encountered Christ on the road and began to preach and found, well, he encountered Christ, then he began to preach, then he began to found churches. But last but not least, look at this. And he says, "I'm telling the truth. I'm not lying. You're a Christian. We shouldn't lie. But sometimes you got to defend yourself. You got to explain yourself to people. Don't be ashamed to explain yourself. People don't understand you. If you're really living for God, you seem weird to people. Because there's so many people that have no notion of God, no connection of God. So if you're living for God, you seem weird. Don't. You might have to say, 'I'm telling the truth. I'm not lying.'" Some of your testimonies, people say, "You making that up." I used to tell the youth things, the youth fellowship, and they would say, "Pastor Taylor, you always got a story." I say, "I'm telling you the truth. This is stories from my life, things that happened to me. I trusted God. God gave me a lot of excitement." Sometimes too much excitement, okay? But you might have to say, "I'm telling the truth, I'm not lying." But look at this last thing, and I'm gonna close on this. Paul says, "I'm a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and in truth." Now, you have to really read Romans 9 and 10. And when you read Romans 9 and 10, let me just go over to Romans 9 and 10 in the easy to read Bible, because it's going to give you a sense of the profundity of this point that I'm making now. Look at what Paul said, and he uses this same term in Romans 9. So he's really saying, this is really true. I am in Christ, and I am telling you the truth. Makes the same statement. I'm not lying. So you know how we black people say, "I ain't lying." We ain't the first ones to come up with that. Paul says it right here. "I ain't lying. And my conscience, ruled by the Holy Spirit, agrees that what I say now is true. I have great sorrow and always feel much sadness for my own people." All you all are saying, you're a Christian, you ain't supposed to look at race, you ain't supposed to think about your people. Forget that. That's why I teach in this church, you should pray for your people. I mean, black Americans first, if you're black American. And then you should pray for all other people, because we're all human. But we're black Americans, and black Americans got a whole lot of problems.
Amen.
Well, Jesus don't see no color. Ask all these white people voting for Trump. Because to them, their whiteness, their Christianity is connected with their whiteness. And even though he's a immoral, dishonest, ungodly man, they're willing to back him because of his racism. That's the main thing. But it's a good thing to feel sadness for your people. When you see how low our standards are, when you see our families, oh Lord, our families so disconnected, you wanna feel something about your people, go around the school and see how wild some of our young people are. You saw those Haitians under that bridge being beaten with whips by white men on horses. You don't have no feelings for your people. Because my understanding of my people is black Americans, but also everyone in the diaspora, all black people from Africa and the Caribbean and all over. Look what Paul said. I have great sorrow and always feel much sadness for my own people. Now, wait now. Over here in 1 Timothy 1 and 7, he says he's a teacher, he's apostle and teacher of the Gentiles. But over here in Romans 9, he's full of sorrow about his own people. They are my brothers and sisters, my earthly family. Reading in the easy to read version, Romans 9. I wish I could help them. I would even have a curse on me and cut myself off from Christ if that would help them. What? I would be unsaved. I'd go to hell if it would help my people. Here's the pattern of sacrifice that I talked about. Paul said, if I could sacrifice myself for my people, I would. They are the people of Israel, God's chosen children. They have the glory of God and the agreements he made between himself and his people. God gave them the law of Moses, the temple, worship, and his promises. They are the descendants of our great fathers, and they are the earthly family of the Messiah, who is God over all things. Notice he calls the Messiah God over all things. Trinitarian formula right there. Praise him forever. Amen. Now, here's an example of a man who loved his people, even as a Christian. This is Romans 9. This ain't Romans 1. This is Romans 9. And the same theme is echoed in Romans 10, that Paul loves the Jewish people. Brothers and sisters, what I want most is for all the people of Israel to be saved. He's still on this point. I love my people. All you all ashamed that you black, all you all talking about Jesus ain't got no color, you crazy. You haven't read the Bible. You don't know the word. You caught up with what white folk want you to do. Because white folk want you to get saved and not see color. You better believe they see color. And you're supposed to see color too, because your first witness is supposed to be where you are. And you can't be effective unless you know the problems of where you are. And y'all know Negroes got some problems. Brothers and sisters, what I want most of all is for the people of Israel to be saved. That is my prayer to God. I can say this about him. They really try hard to follow God, but they don't know the right way. They did not know the way God makes people right with him. And they tried to make themselves right in their own way. So they did not accept Christ, God's way of making people right. Christ ended the law, all you black Hebrews. Christ ended the law so that everyone who believes in him is made right with him. What I want most of all, Paul said, is for Israel to be saved, my people to be saved. But that is not what God appointed him to be. He was not the apostle to the Jews. He was not the dominant Jewish apostle. That was Peter in Rome. God had somebody else to take the job Paul wanted. And instead, Paul found himself washing his hands of Jewish people and say, I'm going to the Gentile. And he became the apostle to the Gentile. God made him something he did not want to be. Brothers and sisters, when you say yes to the Lord appoints you, but it might not be what you want. It might not be where you want. And it might not be who the people you want to. But that's all right. Say yes to God. Because when you say yes to God, all of these streams issue forth from your service. Your labor is never in vain, even if it's in an area where you didn't want to be. I wanted to minister to millionaires and get money, but that might not be what God had for you. God said, go in public housing and talk about Jesus. I wanted to be on TV. Go in your hallway, God said. Talk to somebody in the hallway. I want to go to a big conference. Might not be where God appointed you. Go where God appointed you. That's where the blessing is. All right, I'm going to stop. God ain't fulfilling all your wants and desires. God is not some genie. You want a genie? Go see Aladdin on Broadway. Just open back up. And tell me the black guy playing the genie is really good. That's the only genie you're going to get. God ain't no genie. He ain't saying, you got 3 wishes, I'm gonna give you 3 wishes. No, that's Aladdin. Pay that $50, go to Broadway. God is sovereign, he's a king. Tells you which way to go, tells you what to do. Might not be something you wanna do, but I'm gonna live with it. You go where God tell you to go, you're gonna have a good time. You're gonna be blessed. you do what God wants you to do, you're going to see things that blow your mind. You're going to see, I believe I see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living, the psalmist said. All right. So, let's see who's with us tonight. Now go and give your offering. Go to tcotod.org, give a Wednesday night offering. Go to tcotodgivin and give a Wednesday night offering. Because we are buying stuff. We see all these cords. We can't hardly walk on the floor because we're trying to upgrade our streaming here. And we got to learn what we're doing. We don't know yet. We're a little lost. But we're going to get it. All right? And I want to just read who's with us tonight. Deacon Page is here. Deacon Brickhouse, Sharon Kennedy, Marilyn Tucker, Christine Caraway, Brother Douglas, Tijuana Wiggins, Mark Rita Moore, Gary Prince, Dr. Macbeth, Reverend McDonald, Deacon Robinson, Chanel Penn Dixon, Cynthia Bright, Lorraine Brandt, Trina Cook, Gladys Ellington, Yolanda Roby, Patty McCarthy, Deirdre White, Sister Kearney, Carolyn Taylor, Yvonne Prince, Brother Douglas, Pamela Ingram, Reverend Brother Thompson, Iris Graves, the one and only, Annette Peterson, Tasha Washington, Jesse Thomas, out in Pennsylvania, Tasha Thomas, God bless you all out in Pennsylvania, PA, Priscilla Douglas, Brother Anthony Copeland, down in Atlanta. Atlanta's in the house. God bless you, Brother Copeland. Crystal Jackson, Diane Caldwell, Brother Kearney, Courtney Lyons, Ed Patrick, God bless you, Ed. Kim Jones and Deacon Macbeth. What a mighty host. Let's give that host a hand. Tuning in tonight from all over. But remember this. You are appointed by God. Hallelujah. To be a witness, to have a ministry, and to go to some places that you didn't necessarily want to go. To do some things that might have never entered your mind. But when you do what God wants you to do, you will be so blessed and happy that God uses you to expand the kingdom of heaven. All right, how much time we got left?
2 minutes.
2 minutes, praise God. What we're going to do now is we're going to stop. We're going to take a break. And then we're going to come back now. I hope I have some questions about this, because this is very challenging. This is one of my favorite themes, the unexpected nature of the Christian life. All right? The unexpected nature of the Christian life. Matter of fact, that sounds like the title, the unexpected nature of the Christian life. You don't know what to expect. I told somebody yesterday, Mike Tyson said, everybody got a strategy till they get hit in the mouth. Life will hit you in the mouth. Hallelujah. Your strategy has to be filled by the Holy Spirit. That's the only strategy that's going to work and you're going to be able to maintain. Because Jesus said, you don't know where the wind comes from. You don't know where the wind is going. That's how it is with spiritual people. You don't know where you're coming from all the time. You don't know where you're going, but you're letting the Spirit lead you. Those who are led by the Spirit of God, they are the children of God. Oh, hallelujah. And this is what Paul shows us in this great verse right here. Whoa! I love it. I love it. I love it. I feel it. I feel it. Hallelujah. I never knew that I would be in Brooklyn all my adult life. But it has been wonderful. I've had a ball. It's been great. And I'm looking forward to get greater. But God deals in unexpected things. You got to follow by the Holy Spirit. All right, we're going to stop.
Saturday.
We're going to go out. Saturday. Yes.
Communion kits 1 to 4.
What is Saturday?
Pick up communion kits 1 to 4.
Pick up communion kits 1 to 4 Saturday. Yeah. Oh, it's the end of the month already?
Yes, sir. Tomorrow's the
30th. Tomorrow's the 30th?
Yes, sir.
Well, at least it's payday. Come on, let's praise him.
Hallelujah.
Payday. Oh, end of the month. Our church anniversary coming. Women's Day, October 10th. But first, Saturday at 10 o'clock.
Exercise.
Women's exercise. Listen, it's going to be light exercise, and it's going to be a little bit more heavier. So don't feel, if you feel like, oh, I can't exercise. Yes, you can. Because when you do this, this is exercise. You do this, this is exercise. As a woman on TV got a show called Sit and Be Fit. I can just point my toes up. That's exercise. We're going to have light exercise. Come on out. We're going to be spread out. Spread. We're going to spread Negroes all out. Amen. And we're going to work you out. We're going to have different workout people. One light, one more intense. And then the exercise like this, you get tired, you just stop. Catch your breath. And just be glad you're not exercising in deacon training, where I used to make them do 1,000 jumping jacks, 400 push-ups.
Come on.
And 400 sit-ups.
Woo!
And I'd have them falling out. Amen. But they still working now, all of them people. Amen. Deacon Flowers is still here. His knee is still hurt from all that stuff. But he's still here. So listen, come on out on a Saturday, 1 to 4. Get your communion kit. See some folk. But make it here, 10 women, to work it out. What is it called? What's the women's workout called? Women working it out?
Women's Day Workout.
Women's Day Workout. I'm going to call it Women Working It Out. Come in and work it out. You know? We're so happy that you joined us. Keep this blessed. Be ready for the unexpected. Let the Holy Spirit lead you to the unexpected ground where God is going to take you to places you never thought you'd go, but it's going to be a thriller. Because Jesus is the real thriller. Hallelujah. You see, the devil had Michael Jackson make Thriller with monsters rising from the dead. He's trying to flip the resurrection. The one that rose from the dead is the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the real thriller. That's who you need. And he's not bad. He ain't coming to kill you. He's coming to bless you. Hallelujah. Lord, thank you for this wonderful session. Help us to be ready for the unexpected. Help us to be led by the Holy Spirit to understand the depths of our appointment. Give us to know, Lord, that we can do great things in this life. We can be used by you. We can do things above what we can ask or think if we just let your power work by the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the life of Apostle Paul. Thank you for the pattern of his life. Help his life to inform us as we struggle to fulfill the pattern of salvation in this world. In mighty Master's name, the Lord Jesus, we pray. God's people say,
amen.
All right, thank you so much. We're gone. Come back. We're going to take a break. Come back and join us in 10 minutes. Let's go. Hit it.